table as we had at ours, and I think the mess was very successful. Let's give the Sodexo gang a big round of applause for a wonderful meal. I understand the servers this evening are men and women from our basketball team, and they're raising money for their trip. So Sodexo does a great job with our students of hiring whole teams to work. They're not getting paid for it, but they're putting all the money towards their trip. So we're thrilled that we were able to be used in that way for them. So as you know, we're nearing the close of two incredible days, really, for our ROTC Centennial celebration and symposium. And in a moment, I'm going to introduce Major General Peggy Combs and ask her to give her a summary, kind of be our rapporteur of what has it meant, at least to her, responsible for our Army ROTC program over the last couple of days. She was very instrumental with me, and I first talked to Peg and said we were thinking about doing this. Would she let us? And we kind of communicated back and forth, and she said it would be a great idea. And so, Peggy, thanks for all the help in the beginning and the planning, and I think we both knocked it out of the ballpark with unbelievable speakers for the last 2 days. So Major General Combs' bio is in your symposium program, but for the benefit of our virtual audience, and we're actually also doing this virtually for our students, our graduate students, and all of the ROTC units, let me just give some highlights for our virtual audience. She is the Commanding General of the United States Army Cadet Command, whose mission is to partner with academic universities and colleges to recruit, educate, develop, and inspire senior ROTC cadets in the order for them to get commissioned and become officers of character for our total Army. She's also responsible for partnering with many, many high schools in our country to conduct the junior ROTC program in order to develop citizens of character for a lifetime of commitment and service to our nation, not normally or especially into the United States military, just being great citizens. As a seasoned officer who has worked her way through all the ranks, Major General Combs provides the quintessential model of the type of leader the military wants and the Reserve Officer Training Corps aims to prepare. One that is honorable, trustworthy, competent, able to think critically and creatively, and make sound and timely decisions. She's a graduate of Syracuse University, holds advanced degrees from St. Mary's College and the U.S. Army War College, and has attended the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College. She was a commissioned regular second lieutenant in our Army in the U.S. Army Chemical Corps in May of 1985, and has for the last 30 years has served in a variety of leadership and staff positions, both at the tactical level and the strategic level. Her awards and decorations are highlighted in the program and serve to illustrate her service to nation before self. An article on the Institute of Veterans and Military Families website featured a quote from Major General Combs that summed up how she feels about her 3 decades of service. Quote, she said, "For me, soldiering is truly an affair of the heart. It really is about a love of service, a love of country, and the respect and love of our brothers and sisters in arms that serve with the same heart of service and commitment." Close quote. Let's give her a big Norwich welcome. General Combs.
All right. Well, good evening, everyone. You know what? Hasn't this been a wonderful couple of days? Most of you have been here with us, so I want a bit loud, rounding, resounding applause for Norwich University and their hosting this great event. And as Admiral Schneider talked about, we talked about this, gosh, probably last August. And really kind of talked about how are we going to shape a great event that culminates 100 years of United States ROTC. And what a better place. He called and he said, "Hey, I got your letter about asking all the universities to recognize this great milestone in history." And he said, "I've got to tell you, we want to do something very special at Norwich. We really would like to look at the next 100 years of ROTC as you are the birthplace of ROTC. And I thought, what a great idea. And so we just started bouncing off themes, and I will tell you, there is nobody in our circles that has more WASTA than Admiral Schneider. Do you know, last night we had a rousing speech by the Chief of Staff of the Army, and he really did talk about our future as well as linked us back to the past. And so we were talking at AUSA, I believe, and he said, wouldn't it be great to get the Chief of Staff of the Army? And I'm like, yeah, that would be great. So he goes up in a receiving line and says, hi, sir, I'm Rich Schneider. I'm president of Norwich University. I want to invite you to the 100th anniversary celebration at Norwich University. And we had just literally decided on the dates. And he goes, in the April 21 to 23 timeframe, will you come? And he got commitment right then and there. And I'm going to tell you, I don't think anyone can do that but Rich Schneider. That was incredible. I said, you know, he's got more WASTA than any other general on active duty in the Army. And even though you are a Admiral General, that's his new title affectionately by the Army. But Admiral Schneider asked me to reflect a little bit on some of the themes that we heard throughout the last couple of days in shaping. First of all, we're here to honor our past and then to shape our future. And as we were coming in, we had a few foundational documents that have been written in this last year that kind of really put us on a path towards looking at the future, looking at 2020 to 2025, 2040, 2050, and beyond. And what were, number one, those enduring leadership competencies and attributes that we for sure needed to protect as time went on and preserve in our curriculums and in our leader development experiences? And then second, what are those things that probably need to evolve in our curriculum moving forward to meet those demands of the very complex battlefields and the very dynamic world that were described for us? I think General Perkins did a phenomenal job describing that today, and of course General Milley last night, just talking about the complexity of the world today and into the future. And so we heard some themes, and I've just jotted some down. So let me just tell you, it's potpourri, because I haven't organized them very well. But it's potpourri, and it gives us, I think, some foundational thoughts to take forward into as we look at our strategy for 2025 and beyond. We talked about the enduring need for ethics, ethical character development, and that should never, we should never lose sight of that as the core of ROTC. We talked about developing integrity and developing values and how do those evolve through ROTC curriculum and instruction. We also talked about trust as the bedrock of our profession and the need to be stewards of our professions. And the absolute, it's absolutely concrete requirement to be those stewards of the profession for all of our forces. We talked about the need to integrate some up-and-coming things. We talked a lot about the joint international and interagency environment that we fight in today, that we will continue to fight in the future. And the need to look at cross-cultural competencies and really focus more on those within our curriculums so that our lieutenants that enter our services are able to truly communicate across cross-cultural barriers, have that empathy, and I think one of the cadets put it this way, the soft skills of how we actually coordinate operations amongst cultures. We also talked about curriculums and bringing in an interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary approach to the curriculums so that we're able to expand and broaden the minds of our cadets while they're also expanding and broadening their minds within their major. So for instance, things like the humanities that are taught a lot to our liberal arts and kinds of majors, bringing some of those theories into our instruction in military science in a way that it's applicable to the skill sets that our officers need moving forward, so that we get those skills in folks like our engineers and our STEM majors, whose time is very valuable on universities. Their time is taken up primarily by all of their major classes, and then we throw in there our ROTC instruction, and then you all have your core events as well. So they're already a little too busy for us to go tell them, hey, go take another 12 credit hours of these kinds of classes. But how can we merge those most important principles and knowledge, bits of knowledge, so that we can bring that into the praxis of military science? We talked about the emergence of cyber and understanding cyber and its impact on our operations, and talked about the need for everyone to understand cyber, just not our cyber cadets that are really focusing on that hardcore skill. We also talked about the integration of emotional intelligence and social intelligence skills, the interpersonal skills that allow us as leaders to effectively build teams. Because we really talked about teamwork and leadership as being an inspired leadership, as being truly fundamental to what we have to do in the future. It's something we cannot leave. We do that very well now, but how can we improve upon that in the future? And so those are just a few of those things, and I think the best quote came from one of the working groups, and I think this was the working group that also worked with the other five senior military colleges that we have in ROTC. And the cadet got up there when he was talking about cross-cultural competencies, but I think it applies universally to what we've heard. And he said, add experiences, not curriculum. So in other words, you know, General, don't put more rocks in our rucksack. Just make what we do better. You know, just give us some more experiential learning so that we can get better. And so I think we heard that loud and clear. And those are really the, if I want to say, potpourri of what we have learned here. But what we're going to do is we're going to have a working group that is going to take all of the great notes that we've had over the past 2 days. And we're going to throw together some proceedings that says these are the proceedings from this great event. And then we are going to outbrief them on the Army side at AUSA in October. And we will make sure that, you know, our other services also get everything that we've learned for their own use in their strategy moving forward. And so we're not done yet. We still got one more event. And in many ways, we saved the best for last. And it's my pleasure to introduce to you our last speaker. And he is known in our Army as our futurist. He is right now the director of the Army Future Center, and we call it the Army Capabilities Integration Center and Futures, because he's actually responsible for shaping the Army of the future. And in that, he studies extensively the geopolitical situation and what is going on in this very dynamic world in order to prepare us to be able to develop capabilities to be able to win in that future. And so we asked him here tonight to talk about that future and what he thought ROTC could lend to that future. So I think it's the perfect way to sum up this great conference. And so I'm proud to introduce Lieutenant General H.R. McMaster. He was commissioned in 1984, so he's older than me, from the United States Military Academy at West Point. He uniquely has a PhD in military history from UNC Chapel Hill, so he's got a little bit of our universities within him. He also, prior to his assignment as the Futures Director, he also served as the Commanding General of the Maneuver Center of Excellence in Fort Benning. And for those of you that don't know what's at our Maneuver Center, that's our Armor Center and our Infantry Center for the Army. So he was in charge of maneuver, and there he transformed the complete leader development map for our combat arms officers in infantry and armor. Just amazing work. He's also a career armor guy, but he's a cavalryman. And he, you know, and I will tell you, I learned very young in my career that cavalry is not an official branch of the Army, that it exists only between the men who wear it on their collars, right? That's what I was told early. We're not an official branch, but we sure do exist between the ears of the men who wear it, right? So in his capacity as a great cavalryman, he has commanded at the squadron level, 1st Squadron, 4th Cavalry in Germany, and then at the 06 level, 3rd Armored Cav Regiment. And his most recent deployment, of course, he deployed with 3rd Armored Cav Regiment to Iraq. But his most recent deployment, he was the commander of the Combined Joint Interagency Task Force for Transparency, in other words, anti-corruption, in Kabul. And so, ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor for me to introduce a great friend and a wonderful cavalryman, Lieutenant General H.R. McMaster.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, and thanks to all of you for the privilege of being with you. So Admiral Mrs. Schneider, thank you. General Sullivan, one of my heroes here. General Todd, what a privilege it was to meet you tonight. Admiral Gilmore, one of our greatest allies here from Australia. And then all fellow general officers, but really mainly cadets, faculty members, those who really make this great university work and make ROTC, this awesome program, work for not just our services, but for our nation as well. So it's a privilege to be with you to celebrate the last 100 years, but then also to talk about really the next 100 years and what lies ahead, I think, for our nation and how ROTC will play a critical role to ensuring that our nation remains secure, that we are prepared to deter war, which is really what we want to do, right? But when that fails, to be able to fight and win in future armed conflict and protect our fellow citizens. So as a cavalry officer, you know, I've long admired Norwich. I mean, it has a great cavalry tradition. And Major General Ernest Harmon is my hero. I mean, he really is my hero. And when I first learned about General Harmon, I was about ready to deploy to Desert Storm, Desert Shield at the time. And you know, my executive officer, our troop executive officer at E Troop of the 2nd Cavalry Regiment, was cleaning out his office. You know, and the XO's office has like a little bit of everything. You know, pretty scary. You know, smoke grenades, whatever, I mean, things that weren't supposed to be there. But behind one of the drawers, he pulls out this paper, and the title is "Notes on Combat Actions in Tunisia and North Africa" by General Ernest Harmon, written by General Harmon based on 2nd Armored Division's experience in World War II in North Africa to help all the other divisions prepare for the invasion of Normandy. You must read it. Every cadet, you have to read it. It's brilliant. It is the best preparation for combat that our unit had, and we distilled out of that so many lessons. Fundamentally, it was the division will succeed only as the platoon succeeds. So all of you who are going to be lieutenants in any of our services, what that means is you're not apprentices, you're not novices, you're combat leaders. Everybody will look to you when things get tough in battle, so you have to be a leader in all things from day one. And so, but I could go on and on about his many observations. You know, the most important thing you can do as a leader is put leaders in positions of leadership. And then he had great advice, you know, for, you know, how to fight. You know, one of his axioms was, if it takes a toothpick, use a baseball bat. So I really recommend this paper to you. And so I grew fond of General Harmon, and I read his memoir, Combat General. I took it with me to to Iraq, and it got destroyed there. It was out of print, but a good friend of mine replaced it for me, thank goodness. But anyway, it's just such a privilege to be here as a cavalry officer. You can't help but, you know, but absorb, you know, the cavalry spirit. And you had General Milley here, right, yesterday. And I should tell you, I mean, he should have told you himself, but I'll have to let you in on this. He really wants to be a cavalry officer. He really does. He really, really does. And so he's very covetous of the cavalry. As I mean, you can't blame him, right? So we fought together in South Baghdad. His brigade had been there for about 8 months. We were just getting into the so-called Triangle of Death area, Mamadi Lutafia, Yusufia. And that guy was a great combat commander. He was forward with his soldiers every day. And our regiment learned so much because they had already been there for 8 months. And he didn't have tanks and aircraft and Bradleys, and we cut them to him. We didn't have infantry. He cut infantry to us, and we just got after the enemy together. But one day, we had one of our meetings about how we match up our capabilities together and how we get after the enemy. And he was walking kind of awkwardly, you know, out of the regimental headquarters. And I said, "Mark, what are you doing?" You know, and he was stealing the saber of command, General Patton's saber from the 3rd Cavalry Regiment. He had stuffed it in his pants, you know. So of course I couldn't blame him. I said, "I know you really do want to be cavalry, but give me the saber back, damn it." But what a great opportunity to hear from him as always, and so with so many other Norwich graduates who I've come across my career, right? So Second Lieutenant Michael Hamilton, I think he was probably class of '89, Brian, I think he was. He was a great hockey player here. We called him Bullwinkle because his head was not unlike a moose's rack. It was a very large head. I mean, we were concerned that we might not be able to find, you know, a combat vehicle crewman helmet to fit his head. Actually, the one that we did find, the largest one, it kind of was like a yarmulke on the back of his head. Appropriate for Passover, but it's on the back of his head. But what a great combat leader, a great combat Norwich leader. Brian Radliff, Brian, where are you? Raise your hand. Okay, awesome. Another one of my lieutenants, great. And then a major with us in the 3rd Cavalry Regiment, great combat leader, awesome, awesome combat leader. Scott Breckenridge, who all you know here at your ROTC department. Where's Scott? My first company commander as a tank platoon leader. And then one of our lieutenants stupidly said, "Hey, I think the lieutenants like need an office, you know?" And so Breckenridge at the time, Captain Breckenridge reached behind him. He had one of these heavy, like Samsonite briefcases. He said, "Lieutenants don't need an office. You need the front slope of your tank." And he hurled the Samsonite briefcase at one of my unfortunate colleagues, who was able to deflect it, luckily, and survive the experience. But what I learned so much from that guy. What a great, great leader. I could go on and on about Michael Krause and so many just great, great Norwich graduates who had a huge impact on me. But okay, last week though, I was at Carnegie Mellon University, and I ran into one of your most recent graduates from class of 2015. Her name is Second Lieutenant Maria Lavolsi, who's in our Army's new cyber branch. And so I said, "Hey, I'm going to Norwich. I'm going to your old school. Let me know what you thought about the experience and everything." So she wrote to me, and I think this says everything about RTC and about Norwich. She wrote, "I can honestly say that going to Norwich has led me to where I am today, and I would not have the work ethic and motivation I have if it weren't for attending Norwich. Norwich makes you want to be the best you can be every day." And so, you know, we read a lot today, right, about differences in generations, right, and millennials versus and everything. I mean, so I don't buy into it, because I think that there is a lot more continuity across generations, especially among those who volunteer to serve in our armed forces. And there are a lot more continuities and differences, I think, among these generations. Our military is a living historical community. And ROTC, one of the key things ROTC does, is it helps us to preserve the legacy of honor, courage, and selfless service that we have inherited from those who have gone before us. Some of those at this front table who are heroes of mine, heroes like General Ernest Harmon. So when Captain Alden Partridge planted the seeds of ROTC, when he founded what became Norwich University in 1819, his goal was to prepare citizen soldiers to defend our republic through a national system of education of professional and militia officers. Later, in the 19th century, angered in part by the defection of so many West Pointers, I hate to say that, to the Confederacy during the Civil War, Congress included the requirement for military training in the Morrill Act of 1862. That's in the established land-grant universities. So we expand, we see this expanding of training citizens to become soldiers in the professional armed forces and in the militia, or the full-time armed forces in the militia. In 1916, of course, General Leonard Wood, as he watched the carnage of the Great War in Europe from afar, he wanted to create a body of reserve officers to enable the Army to expand should the United States be drawn into another war. The National Defense Act established ROTC as a formal program, or into that war or subsequent wars. So that system for training and educating civilian volunteers to become leaders and warriors in our armed services is as vital to our nation's security today as it was throughout the 20th century, the century that was the bloodiest in human history. And that is because the stakes today are high. They're very high. Threats to national security and all humanity are increasing, and our military is shrinking. And so the need for ROTC is certain to grow. It is certain to grow because our nation will have to respond to those threats and is likely to struggle to develop the capabilities and regain the size and strength necessary to secure our nation. The stakes are high today because we are engaged, as previous generations were engaged, against enemies that pose a grave threat to all civilized peoples. We must defeat modern-day barbarians like Daesh and Al-Qaeda, who cynically use a perverted interpretation of religion to perpetuate ignorance, incite hatred, and commit the most heinous crimes against innocence. The stakes are high because battlegrounds overseas are inexorably connected to our own security. We see those connections as the Islamic State controls territory to plan and prepare for mass murder in France, Belgium, Lebanon, Turkey, Egypt, Iraq, and across the greater Middle East and Africa. We see connections as these terrorists entice masses of disaffected young people with a sophisticated campaign of propaganda, disinformation, and brainwashing. We see connections as terrorists, along with the brutal actions of the Assad regime, Iranian proxies, and Russian forces in Syria, caused the greatest mass migration and humanitarian catastrophe since World War II. And because the stakes are high today, as they were in the previous century, we need ROTC to do two fundamental things, not only for our military, but also for American society. First, preserve our warrior ethos. And second, help warriors remain connected to their fellow citizens, those in whose name we fight and serve. So the warrior ethos is a covenant. It's a covenant between all of us in the military, comprised of values such as honor, duty, courage, loyalty, and self-sacrifice. But our warrior ethos also depends on our military's connection to our society. That is because when we in our military are valued by our fellow citizens, we value ourselves. Ultimately, it is the warrior ethos that permits servicemen and women to see themselves as part of a community that sustains itself through sacred trust and a covenant that binds them not only to one another, but also to our society and to our nation. The warrior ethos is important. It's important because it's what makes units effective in combat. It's also important because it's what makes war less inhumane. We need ROTC more than ever because the warrior ethos is at risk. The warrior ethos is at risk because fewer and fewer Americans are connected to our professional military. The warrior ethos is at risk because fewer and fewer Americans understand what is even at stake in the wars in which we are engaged today. How many Americans could, for example, even name the three Taliban groups that we have been fighting in Afghanistan and Pakistan since 2001? The warrior ethos is at risk because some argue that victory over an enemy or winning in war is an old idea that is no longer relevant in today's complex world. The warrior ethos is at risk because some continue to advocate for simple, mainly technological solutions to the problem of future war, ignoring war's very nature as a human and political activity that is fundamentally a contest of wills. The warrior ethos is at risk because popular culture waters down and coarsens the warrior ethos. Warriors are most often portrayed as fragile, traumatized human beings. Hollywood tells us little about the warrior's calling or commitment to his or her fellow warriors, or what compels him or her to act courageously, endure hardships, take risks, or make sacrifices. So ROTC is indispensable today to help both future officers and our fellow citizens understand war and understand warriors. And we need ROTC more than ever to help keep our military connected to those in whose name we fight. And that's because in our democracy, if society is disconnected from an understanding of war or is unsympathetic to the warrior ethos, it will become increasingly difficult to maintain the fundamental requirements of military effectiveness and to recruit young men and women into the military service. So we might emphasize above all to our cadets and to our citizens that our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen are both warriors and humanitarians. They are warriors and humanitarians because they fight in places like Afghanistan, Syria, and Iraq against those who commit mass murder and genocide, torture and enslave, rape, and commit the worst kinds of child abuse. They are warriors and humanitarians because they defend our children and our way of life on modern-day frontiers between barbarism and civilization. So what might the ROTC curriculum emphasize in the next 100 years to preserve our warrior ethos and help our military stay connected to our society? The opportunity to study war and warfare and warriors across the curriculum, not just in ROTC programs, holds promise for enabling cross-discipline, interactive, reflective learning in a way that accomplishes both objectives. Historical experience and military history in particular is an ideal vehicle, not only for preserving the warrior ethos and connecting warriors and citizens, but also for enriching and connecting military instruction with the study of other disciplines such as philosophy, theology, and law, with an emphasis on applied ethics, as General Combs already mentioned, just war theory, military honor, and stoicism, and what that means to the warrior ethos and to our professional ethic. Language, geography, and area studies, as General Combs already mentioned as well, to understand and develop empathy. Empathy for the cultures and historical experience of the peoples among whom wars are fought. Literature. Literature to reflect on examples of positive and negative leadership, as well as the human experience and morality and immorality of war. Leadership to understand the importance of setting the example, determining a vision, team building, keeping soldiers informed, and managing combat stress. Math, science, and engineering to consider technological and scientific change in context, though, of human, political, cultural, and psychological continuities in war. Physiology and psychology to understand how to improve human and team strength, performance, and resilience. So encouraging universities to offer and cadets to pursue an interdisciplinary approach to the study of war will help integrate academic, military, and physical development to produce leaders of character who possess the intellect and the determination to win against these enemies we're facing and to win in this complex world. That would provide an opportunity for future military leaders and fellow students to discuss what they might expect from each other. Those discussions might provide a corrective to the tendency in our country to confuse military studies with militarism. As the English theologian, writer, and philosopher G.K. Chesterton observed, war is not the best way of settling differences, but it is the only way of preventing them from being settled for you. And as George Washington once observed, to be prepared for war is the most effectual means to promote peace. So we ought to study war in a way that's analogous to what Raymond Bradbury was trying to do in the great novel Fahrenheit 451. When he was interviewed, an interviewer said, "Are you trying to predict the future?" He said, "Hell no, I'm trying to prevent it." And so the study of war is important to the preservation of peace. So those discussions could promote moral conduct by generating empathy for others, as General Combs already said, in an effort to prevent war or at least make war less inhumane. As a Roman emperor and Stoic philosopher Marcus Aurelius observed, respect becomes concrete through empathy. Empathy developed through the study of war is important not only to the development of military leaders who are both warriors and humanitarians, but also to the preservation of our identity and strength as a nation. Those discussions between young men and women in our universities could help young cadets and young students understand and respect their roles. Their roles as warriors, humanitarians, and citizens. Those discussions about the study of war and warfare from an interdisciplinary perspective will provide future officers not only with a strong understanding of their profession, but also a solid foundation for further education and self-development. The goal should be to spark intellectual curiosity. It would be consistent with Clausewitz said about military theory. It's not to accompany you to the battlefield to make your decisions for you, but it's just as a wise teacher guides a student in their self-education, that your knowledge of war is not to lead you by the hand, but to allow you to deal with complex situations, ask the right questions, and to learn across a career of service. So ROTC graduates don't have to be experts. But ROTC graduates must know enough to be humble and sensitive to the limits of reasoning by historical analogy, but also confident enough to continue learning and to be engaged on contemporary issues of national security. So unless future officers study war and warriors, lessons from even our most recent military experiences will, in the words of the great historian Carl Becker, lay inert in unread books. That would not only be regrettable, it would be dangerous. Dangerous to the national interest and dangerous to those who do the fighting. Humanity needs American warriors now more than ever. The stakes are high, but we should be confident. Confident because ROTC and the universities like this great university that host ROTC will continue to develop young men and women who are warriors and humanitarians. Confident because ROTC will help keep our servicemen and women connected to their fellow citizens. So to cadets here this evening and ROTC leaders and the faculty and staff who are training and educating our next generation of Army leaders, thank you for your service to our nation and humanity. And thank you for the great privilege of being with you to celebrate this awesome anniversary. Thank you very much.
General, I can't think of a better way to wrap this up, but he's willing to take questions for a few minutes, maybe 10 or so. There's one mic tonight. This is a small, intimate wardroom or mess tent party. So would you like to, anyone like to step up to the mic?
Good evening, sir. I'm Cadet Walbridge. I'm junior here in the Corps of Cadets, and I'll hopefully be commissioning in the United States Air Force next year. I also work for Google as a part-time job as a student ambassador for our university on their tech side of everything. And one thing Google teaches us is it is okay to fail, as long as you pick yourself up and learn from that. What words of wisdom would you be able to give all of us, both cadets, adults, professionals, even fellow generals, that other people would consider your biggest failure or one of your biggest failures, but that you saw as a learning experience, that you picked yourself up and continue to move on?
Okay, well, you know, the older you get, the better you were. You know what I mean? So it's hard to come up with things as you look back in retrospect, you know. But, gosh, I'm sure there were a lot of failures in my career, but I was very fortunate to grow up in an environment where leaders underwrote mistakes and encouraged you to make mistakes of omission. So in the cavalry, our culture is that the only mistake you can make is to say you're waiting for orders, right? And then leaders underwrite the mistakes of leaders if they're taking risks to, you know, to try to maintain the initiative over the enemy and so forth. You know, we actually, I think, ought to really push the limits of our capabilities and to recognize that good units occasionally fail because they do push the limits of their capabilities so they can get better in training and not have to pay the cost in blood, you know, in the future. But, gosh, I mean, there are probably hundreds of failures I could tell you about in my career, but not one that I can think of that's worthy of an object lesson at this moment, but great question.
Great, next.
Good evening, sir, my name is Liam Carroll. I'm a junior cadet here at Norwich.
A little louder, Liam, please.
Oh, excuse me. I'm a junior cadet here at Norwich. I was wondering what you think the biggest threat is facing our Army today.
Okay. I think the biggest threat facing our Army today, in terms of external threats, you know, it's very hard to predict, obviously, where the next war is going to be. But we're already at war against a resurgent Taliban that have regenerated and continue to regenerate across the border in Pakistan and Afghanistan. And, of course, the stakes are high there for the nation, but also for our soldiers who are fighting there alongside Afghan soldiers. Because you could be faced with the prospect of the return of a safe haven and support base or a weak and criminalized narcotic state that could fund transnational terrorist organizations who already want to kill our children. The stakes are extremely high in the greater Middle East with the establishment of a terrorist proto-state in the greater Middle East and this humanitarian catastrophe I mentioned, but also this very destructive civil war between the Sunni and Shia Arab populations there. It's even more complicated than that, obviously, when you throw in the ethnic aspects of the conflict. And then, of course, Russia's intervention with, I think, what you might call an axis of Russia, Iran, and the Assad regime. I think what Iran is trying to do is apply the Hezbollah model to the Middle East broadly, where they have weak governments in power that are dependent on the Iranians for support, where they grow militias and other groups that can be turned against those governments if those governments take action against Iranian interests. It's a situation in Iraq, you know, where the Iraqi government and security forces are in large measure subverted and infiltrated by the Islamic Revolutionary Guards Corps and their proxies. The pressure that President Haider al-Abadi's under right now is really that begins with Iran, who is raising the problem set and really, in effect, trying to besiege him through the Sutterists and so forth. And then we have problems from other nation states as well. And I think that the prospect for great power conflict or for a major international military crisis is larger today than it has been since after World War II. And the reason is you have revisionist powers that are surrounded by weak states that are taking aggressive action and are trying to remake, I think, the global political, economic, and security order in a way that is at disadvantage to U.S. interests and to reorder those arrangements in favor of their interests. And that's Russia, China, and then, of course, it's hard to understate the problem of associated with North Korea and the danger. To the Army itself, I think we're facing kind of a triple whammy, as one report called it recently, where we have a very significant drawdown in the size of the force, I think way too small. You know, I think that an active army of 450, based on what's going on in the world, is too small to secure a nation, total force of 980,000. And so army forces are increasingly committed, which means fewer and fewer land forces are available to surge to contingency operations. And if you combine that large drawdown in the number of the size of the force with the huge cut in the modernization budget, 1/50th of the procurement budget in Department of Defense is for land systems. But that's where we're fighting today. And so our enemies who have been studying us very carefully since the Gulf War have been adapting and improving their militaries, and we have not modernized really to fight those kind of enemies. And so our budget is down when the need to modernize to stay ahead is very great. So what we would do about that? Well, in a democracy, you get the army that the American people are willing to pay for, right? And it's our job as general officers and leaders to do the best you can with what you've got. So our chief has prioritized readiness first. And what we need to do is, I think, make a sustained case to our leaders and to the American public on why, you know, their sons and daughters in the army need the benefit of probably some additional sources and more men and women standing next to them, so we have sufficient depth and capacity in the force.
Just a small part too, sir. Just given the current circumstances, what do you think we can do on the company and platoon level to affect this?
Well, I mean, the mission is simple in platoons and companies: make your piece of the army the best it can be, right? And you can do that even with limited resources. And so the key is to make sure that you ask yourself every day, if we were to go to combat tomorrow, if we were in battle tomorrow, what would we most wish we had trained on? And so, you know, develop in that unit a commitment to excellence, where excellence is self-sustaining. You know, build into your training what happens in combat: bad information, casualties, rush things from time to time. Challenge your unit, challenge your young men and women. They're soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, Coast Guardmen. They expect the military to be hard. They're disappointed when it's not, right? Challenge them. And what you'll see is a really cohesive team come together. And it's tremendously rewarding. I mean, being a lieutenant and a captain, it is the best job in our military. Because what happens is you're part of an organization where the man or woman next to you is willing to give everything, including their own lives, for you. Where else is that replicated? Anywhere. And what you'll see is you'll see that team become a family. And they are bound together by that sacred trust and confidence and respect. And you can foster that through your leadership.
Thank you, sir.
Nice.
Sir, Cadet Michael Carrera, senior here in the Army ROTC program. Now, you'd mentioned modernization, and you obviously we have many enemies that are very in the spotlight right now, such as ISIL or other organizations that cause a lot of loud noise on the news, we'll say. Do you believe we have any more silent enemies that are also modernizing their militaries at this point in time?
Any more what, I'm sorry?
Any more... I say silent enemies, but anyone that's kind of hiding in the back, modernizing along with us, that could potentially become a threat to the young leaders.
Yeah, I mean, they're not really hiding, right? So Russia and China, for example, you know, I think are engaged in an activity that two authors in a recent book called The Unquiet Frontier, this is Wes Mitchell and Jakob Griegel, I recommend the book. They have sort of categorized the strategic behavior that they're engaged in as probing, which is really trying to to challenge U.S. interests at the far reaches of American power, and to create, you know, use really a sophisticated campaign that's not just military action, but it's really unconventional forces under the cover of conventional forces, a sophisticated propaganda, you know, campaign, and an effort to sow dissent among partners and allies. And I think you see this with what Russia has put on display in terms of capabilities in Syria, but before that with the invasion of Georgia in 2008, the annexation of Crimea, and then the invasion of Ukraine. And so a lot of those capabilities are on display, and I think have been a bit of a wake-up call for us. Those involve, you know, like massed artillery fires that are tied to unmanned aerial systems, sophisticated cyber electromagnetic capabilities to disrupt our network systems. You see advanced combat vehicles with active protective systems, improved lethality in their anti-tank weapons, you know, for example. So I think we have learned quite a bit about that already, and we're shifting some priorities to make sure that we can maintain overmatch over what are increasingly capable enemies. Enemies that have not remained static, you know, who've been watching us and are trying to improve. I think the key thing, I think there are four implications for defense strategy right now based on what we've seen from Russia. The first implication is allies are more important than ever, right? And so this is a return of geopolitical theory of the late 19th and early 20th centuries, Thomas Mackinder. These conflicts are occurring in shatter zones on the borders of revisionist powers that are trying to remake the world in a way that is more amenable and sympathetic to their interests. It's a very dangerous time as a result of that. So allies are very important. The second thing is that American military power is joint power. You need synergy between air, land, and sea forces. I think we have this tendency to invest in high technology, mainly in maritime aerospace forces, and neglect land forces, even when I think it's quite apparent that we need all capabilities, right? So I just point out that all of the conflicts that you see occurring are about the control of territory, and that ISIL doesn't have a navy or an air force, and they're doing okay. So what you need is you need the synergistic effect of capable air, maritime, cyberspace, and land forces. The third implication, you know, for us is that we have to really resurrect deterrence theory. We have, I think, bought into this idea that we can deter these powers through the threat of punitive action later, rather than deterrence by denial. You know, and that means convincing your enemy that your enemy cannot accomplish their objectives. And so I think this argues for the forward positioning of forces along these frontiers where you have forces like Russia or countries like Russia that are waging limited war for limited objectives. Think about what Russia did in Ukraine. They invaded Ukraine at zero cost to them, consolidated gains over that territory, and then portrayed the response as escalatory. And so the only way really to deter a force that's waging limited war for limited objectives is to ratchet up the cost at the frontier, like we did with the force that remained in Korea since 1953.
Thank you very much, sir.
This is the last question.
Good evening, sir. Cadet Eric Mentes, Senior Air Force Cadet here. Earlier at the panel, General Perkins talked about self-development, and he said you were the go-to guy and you had more information on this, and that sparked my curiosity. So I was hoping you could elaborate on self-development, and if there's a formula or ways to promote someone to try and improve each day.
Okay. I would say that, I mean, the key to it is, I think, it's read military history, think about it, and discuss it. And then read it purposefully, read really the good books that are going to help you understand better the experiences of those who have gone before you, right? Think about how arrogant it would be if we all said, hey, you know, I'm going to lead young men and women into combat, but all I need to know to do that effectively is my own personal experience, right? No, I mean, you know, you have to learn from others, right, to inform your judgment. And so I think the key thing is to read and to read in a focused way. There's a resource available on the Fort Benning webpage. If you go to the Fort Benning webpage and go to Leader Development, it's called the Maneuver Leader Self-Study Program. And in that program, there's an introduction for each topic. So one of it is how to use history to understand your profession and your responsibilities. That's one of the topics. Another topic is moral, ethical, and psychological preparation of soldiers and teams for combat to operate in environments of persistent danger and uncertainty. How do you preserve the moral character of a unit in those difficult circumstances? So those are just examples of the topics. Then there's a discussion of what the topic is, why it's important to leaders, and then a suggestion about how to go about studying it with like a reading list. And what you should, I think the way to do it is to read, you know, a good book with an article that kind of synthesizes the topic, and then look at films and have a discussion. The social aspect of it is really key. And you can form a study group, you know, just using Facebook or something. You can pick the book, read it, you know, discuss. Even for those of you who are graduating, you stay in contact with each other and do that. And if you're ever reading, like, a really boring book and it's boring you, just bag it. Move on to another book, right? I mean, just don't, I mean, find the books that interest you and that you can you think you can learn from and you're excited about and read those.
Great questions.
Thank you.
Fabulous answers. What a way to wrap up two wonderful days. So I know Captain Partridge and General Harmon, and I know General Sullivan are proud of you. And thanks for making true our mission of educating and training young officers in service to America tonight. I'm going to give you one of my presidential coins of excellence.
Thank you.
With
so
great
thank
thanks
you.
To you, sir, for coming.
Thank you.
Wrapping up our conference.
Thanks.
And I know Alex Brindell, our wonderful regimental commander,
thank
who nobody wants to sit with, has a presentation he wants to make.
Dude, you just can't catch.
He had a tough job at dinner because, as the admiral said, challenge the old guys at your table. Hey, there were all old guys at the table and gals, but actually, Peggy's very young. So,
sir, thank you for coming here and concluding our presentation and our evening. And this reads, in appreciation for inspiring words at the ROTC Centennial Symposium, Norwich University, April 22nd.
How did you know they were going to be inspiring?
2016. We know you, sir.
We're
ready.
Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
Sir.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
So, I wonder if Diane Schiller, I see her there, and where's Kathleen? Kathleen Murphy, where are you? Right here, stand up. Both ladies come a little forward. Guys, you have to give these two women the biggest round of applause ever. They have pulled this entire 2 days off when we started with General Combs. I want to say personally, well done. Unbelievable. You two made us shine the last couple days, just sparkle, so thank you. We have some other things for you to think about as well. At your table is a very unique memorabilia piece from this 100th birthday of ROTC. It's in your ammo box. You all need to take one home. You may want to put this in your luggage, though, I'd check in the luggage. I wouldn't carry this in your book bag when you're going through TSA. But it is a bottle opener, it's not a whistle or anything like that, but I think it speaks to what we were trying to do today. And also, I want to say a special thank you for our salute ale. Now, just so I can point it out, where is it actually, in the back? Kathleen or Diane, is it back there on that corner, over there? All right, so Major Gagne, on your feet. This man is an entrepreneur. Yes, big round of applause for this wonderful Norwich guy. So Major Gagne has always wanted to be a brewmaster, and he's an entrepreneur, and he's a wonderful Army officer, and he's here every day with us now because we worked out a great agreement with the Vermont National Guard, and he's leading from the front while his guys are brewing beer up in St. Albans. And he's had a different brew each year because, you know, we're celebrating our bicentennial for 5 years. It's one awesome five-year program. And so this is a new brew called Salute Ale. And it's here for you to take home if you'd like. Now, cadets, listen up. You can't take this back in the barracks. We'll have to work something out with Alex, and we'll hold it for you, and you can pick it up from Kathleen or Diane Scalera because I don't want you getting vapped just before graduation. That's not a good strategy. But for the rest of you that are over 21, you can have this, and I want to thank Major Gagne for providing it. Thanks very, very much. I'll remind everybody about the 5K fun run tomorrow in honor of our JROTC. You have been an awesome audience. Thank you to our presenters. Thank you for those of our guests that were embedded in our classrooms. Thanks again to Kathleen and Diane. Thanks for the entire gang that put this all together. Norwich forever. Have a great night. Safe trip home.